Thank you, Brother Given. The last time that I participated and spoke at the renewal was at the one that met down in Alabama. And I drove all the way from Grayson down to Alabama, and I got as far as Nashville, which, if you know your geography, is more than halfway there. And I come to realize I'd forgotten my Bible and my notes. So when I got there, I had to do a little fast thinking, borrowed a Bible from the preacher, and tried to reconstruct my notes. Well, tonight, I'm not going to do that. I have my Bible, and I have a lot of notes. So if you find me staying fairly close to those notes, you'll know the reason. But it is a real privilege to be with you folk and to share with you tonight on this very, very important subject, the communion of the blood of Christ. That's taken, as you well know, from the 10th chapter of 1 Corinthians. And the phrase is found in a very, very significant question. In the King James, it is, "The cup of blessing which we bless, is it not a communion of the body of Christ, of the blood of Christ?" And then following, "And is not the bread that we break a participation, a communion, a fellowship in the body of Christ?" I think it's so sad that what we have done to words and their meanings. Sociologically, to be politically correct, we can no longer refer to people of color as Negro or even black. They must be referred to now as African Americans. And if we don't refer to them in those exact terms, then we're tagged with the label of racist. Or, religiously, some of our ultra-feministic friends insist that no gender-specific terms can be used in addressing God. He is not Father, nor should he be referred to as He, and His Son is not son, but offspring. And as a result, as you know, Bibles have to be modified, hymns have to be rewritten, and all gender-specific language must be eliminated from public worship. Well, we can expect that in certain circles. But isn't it strange that even within that Christian community that claims to seek New Testament Christianity and places a high premium on biblical revelation, attempting to interpret its language in faithful terms so that Scripture may indeed speak truth, isn't it strange that there is also a tragic recognition of deterioration in word meanings among such people? Now, some of this is deliberate, but most has come as we have allowed the relativism of our age to affect us adversely. And since words and concepts and meaning are no longer demanded in our relative and supposedly relevant society, this pattern has affected God's people, and our teaching and preaching may even reflect this. Because you see, what we're doing is giving more attention to the visceral and the emotional and less to the rational and the cerebral. Now, many examples could be given, but the only one that I want to venture to present tonight is tied to our text. There in our text, the English word communion is used in the King James Version to translate the Greek word koinonia. But what has happened with that perfectly good word? We've applied that word communion to the Lord's Supper, and we have rightly done that, as we shall see. But how vapid the term has become in its wider use. Have you ever heard expressions like this? "Did you take communion this morning?" Or, "What do you think about our communion service?" Or, "I love the quiet during communion." Or, "The time of communion is a good time to commune with the Lord." And we hear that, and that certainly does not delve to the very depths of the meaning of that term communion. Well, someone will say, well, let's use that better word fellowship. And when we use that, perhaps we'll get away from the way in which that term communion is used. But even the word fellowship has fallen prey to the same kind of innocuous use. Fun, food, and fellowship, we say. Or all this will take place in our fellowship hall. Or the fellowship is wonderful. We had even some of our restoration pioneers who seem to assume that the fellowship that is mentioned in Acts 2:42 has to refer to the offering or the contribution. After all, we must find a pattern for New Testament worship, and Acts 2:42 has been chosen. Now, true, in certain passages, such as 2 Corinthians 8:4 and Romans 15:2, and particularly Philippians 4:15, we do find fellowship referred to that kind of participation in the sharing of material goods with the people of God. But to say that that's all that fellowship can mean certainly is to see a very limited picture of what the term fellowship means as we see it from the standpoint of the New Testament. But other New Testament understandings of fellowship are ignored. Fellowship of faith in Philemon 6, or the fellowship of his sufferings, or the fellowship of truth and light that's found there in 1 John 1, 6 and 7. These are, and then there are those negative presentations of fellowship, such as to have no fellowship with unfruitful deeds of darkness, or to have no fellowship with the devil, as we see here in this very chapter that we'll be looking at. After all, Paul says in 2 Corinthians 6, what fellowship has righteousness with unrighteousness? And so we come back to our text. We ask, what does Paul mean when he says, is not this a communion or fellowship with the blood of Christ? It seems to me that the New International Version has become a little more careful in its translation, because rather than using either communion or fellowship, it uses in those two passages the term participation. Is not our participation as we drink that cup, is it not in the blood of Jesus Christ? Well, what I want to do is look at this text, and perhaps we can do so by lifting up three basic hermeneutical principles and apply them to the text. First, I want to apply the lexical principle, and secondly, the contextual principle, finally, the historical principle, and then after doing that, we'll try to summarize what we have discussed. By the lexical principle, we mean attempting to discover the meaning of words or concepts or phrases used by the inspired author. And there are three words or concepts that are quite apparent in our text. The cup of blessing, which we bless, is one of those terms. The fellowship or the communion or participation is the second of those terms. And the third is, of course, the term blood of Christ. And I want to look at those concepts, those ideas, in reverse order. First, look at the blood of Christ. That expression, as we will know if we continue through this conference, is used frequently in the New Testament. And not only is it used frequently, but it is used in a very specific kind of way, with great meaning, with wide implication. For example, as our good brother pointed out this morning, the church has been purchased by his own blood, according to Paul there in Acts, the 20th chapter. Or as we heard this afternoon, in Romans 3, that great passage where Paul says that God set forth Jesus as a propitiation through faith in his blood. But in addition to those passages, which have been treated so masterfully already, we have such passages as Ephesians 1:7, where Paul says we have redemption through his blood. Amen. Or in Colossians 1, where Paul again emphasizes that peace has been made through his blood. And Peter, who so clearly sets out this truth does so in that first chapter when he says that we're redeemed not by corruptible things like silver or gold from that way which our fathers handed down, but by the precious blood of Christ as of a lamb without spot and without blemish.
Amen.
And then in 1 John 1 and 7, we'll come back to this passage. There is that great, great statement, that great affirmation that the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanses us or continues to cleanse us from all sin. Amen. We turn to the book of Revelation, and not only does John see Jesus as the one who has washed us from our sins in his blood, but there in one of those visions as recorded in the 7th chapter of Revelation, he sees those saints of the ages who have made their garments white in the blood of the Lamb.
Amen.
And the epistle to the Hebrews is filled with expressions that contrast, on the one hand, the blood of bulls and goats, which could never, never redeem, with that blood of our great high priest Jesus, whose blood is shed finally, once and for all, to provide eternal redemption. And there in Hebrews 9 and 10, that is spelled out in such a marvelous way. And so that inspired writer could say that the blood of Christ is, and we find this in Hebrews 13, 20, the blood of an everlasting covenant.
Amen.
And in anticipation of that, Jesus inaugurated the cup as a symbol of the blood of the new covenant shed unto many for the remission of sins there in that upper room on the night that he was betrayed. The blood of Christ is one of those concepts, one of those phrases, one of those significant ideas that is so filled with great meaning that we can only touch the hem of the garment in our attempt to understand it. But take a look at that second word, communion, fellowship, koinonia. This word speaks of the interpenetration of the whole body of Christ with the divine. And it's used to speak of participation in the blood of Jesus Christ. That participation, that sharing, that fellowship is focused in the cup of blessing, which all Christians share in the Lord's Supper. But behind that lies the continued fellowship or participation which is promised to every Christian. And perhaps that passage in 1 John 1 through 7 is the best commentary of the total focus of our fellowship, our participation in and with Christ, and points up the benefits accruing because of who Christ is and because of the effect of his cleansing blood. Turn there to 1 John 1. John begins that epistle by saying, that which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we've seen with our eyes, which we have looked at, and our hands have touched, this we proclaim concerning the word of life. For the life appeared, and we have seen it, and testify to it, and we proclaim to you the eternal life which was with the Father and has appeared to us. There's no question but what John is talking about, that eternal word that came in flesh, and there in the presence of John and those others was known in every conceivable way, witnessed and evidenced by them that here indeed was God's Son, the man from heaven. And he says, we proclaim to you what we have seen and heard, so that you also may have fellowship with us, and our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ, and we write this to make our joy complete.
Amen.
And this is the message, John continues, that we have heard from him and declare to you, that God is light, and in him there is no darkness at all. And if we claim to have fellowship with him, yet walk in darkness, we lie. We do not live by the truth. But if we walk in the light, as he is in the light, if we meet the conditions of fellowship, then we have fellowship with one another.
Amen.
And the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, purifies, cleanses us from all sin. Amen. This is the kind of participation that is ours, at which we are reminded at the table when Lord's Day by Lord's Day we come to worship Him. And then the third of those phrases is the cup of blessing which we bless. Paul here is referring to that consecrated cup shared by every believer as they gather to participate in the body and blood of Jesus. For Jesus had taken the cup of blessing, which was there at the Passover supper. He had blessed it. He had thanked God for it. And then he'd ask all of his disciples to drink from it. For, he said, this is the blood of the new covenant shed for many unto the remission of sin. There is no question in Paul's mind that Jesus intended to see the cup as the reminder of his sacrifice and to link all blood-washed saints into a partnership of remembrance, a partnership of meaning, a partnership that would lead to consecrated lives. Now, words and phrases, concepts, are brought together in what we call syntactical relationship. And these terms, the blood of Christ, the participation, the fellowship, the koinonia, and the cup of blessing, are linked together, as we see here in this particular passage, in an interrogative sentence, a question, if you please. But it's a peculiar kind of question. It's a question that demands a positive answer. The only reply possible is to affirm what is asked. Yes, yes, the cup of blessing is indeed a participation in the blood of Christ. This is why it was given by Jesus on the eve of his sacrifice. This is why he commanded, do this in remembrance of me. And this is why the early church did so each Lord's Day, and perhaps in the beginning daily. And in light of that norm, as seen in the New Testament scripture, each Lord's Day we center our worship in this simple remembrance of God's mighty act at Calvary. Amen. Here, indeed, is the lexical principle. These are the concepts, the terms that are found here in our passage. And if we can understand those terms in light of the full range of scripture, perhaps we can better understand the passage itself. But let's look at the contextual principle. The immediate context is, of course, the deep significance of the bread and cup. Verse 16 notes that just as the cup helps us participate in the blood of Christ, the bread functions in the same way. You have the same syntax, the same interrogative question, the same positive answer that is demanded. And Paul continues that all who do participate are one loaf, one body. One could almost add, without harm to the context, one blood, since we participate as a body. The Lord's Supper, then, along with baptism, as seen there in 1 Corinthians, the first chapter, verse 10 and following, stands as a great symbol of the unity of all believers in Christ. That which unites us is that to which we have been introduced by our baptism and participate in the supper. And that, of course, is the death and the resurrection of Jesus, his life given as a ransom for us all. But the wider context, beginning with chapter 8, is Paul's response to the question of eating meat sacrificed to idols. If you know the structure of 1 Corinthians, you know that there were certain questions that the Corinthians asked Paul, and these are introduced by a little expression, a formula, peride. And this is one of those peride questions. What should we do with regard to meat sacrificed to idols? Well, now Paul asserts, as you know, reading back there in chapter 8, that there are no idols, so whatever may be offered in ignorance does nothing to that which is offered. However, he points out that there is a principle that the mature Christian must see and apply, and that he's to recognize the immature's lack of knowledge and therefore the immature's lack of confidence. Paul uses his own example as an illustration. He says, I'm free, but I will never use my freedom, even the freedom of the apostle. I will never use that freedom to cause my brother to stumble. And here in chapter 9, as he continues to speak of that freedom and the implications of it, here he sees that he does indeed have something in which he could boast, and that is to preach the gospel freely. But even there, he sees the danger, so that, as he says, he disciplines himself rigorously so that he will not be rejected after he has preached to others. The wider context also emphasizes the examples in Old Testament Scripture, as we see in chapter 10. Israel had begun well as they left Egypt. They had been baptized into Moses, and they were eating and drinking that same spiritual food and drink, which was Christ, Paul said. But God was not pleased with many because they had become idolaters, they'd become fornicators, they'd become murmurers. And all of these things stand, Paul points out to his readers, as our example. They are indeed for our warning, for our benefit. And therefore, Paul makes these conclusions in regard to that. Let him that thinks he stands be sure that he does not fall, as we read there in the 12th verse of chapter 10. But he also points out that God is faithful. He will not allow us to be tempted beyond our ability to endure. Amen. And that in verse 13. So, he says, flee idolatry. Yes. And then he adds, I speak to wise men. I speak to men of discernment. And then comes these texts that we are looking at. And beyond that text in this same chapter, the remainder of the section Paul uses to refer to the priesthood as the priesthood of the Old Testament, as participants, partakers of the altar. And he says, so it is with heathen deities. Even though they do not exist, those participating in the eating participate in the idolatry in their minds and in their understanding. The final cry of Paul is, you cannot drink of the cup of the Lord and the cup of devils. You cannot be a guest. You cannot partake at the Lord's table and the table of devils. And Paul comes back to the principle of freedom introduced in chapters 8 and 9. All things, even eating meat sacrificed to an idol that I do not even believe exists, that is, the idol doesn't exist. All things are lawful, Paul says, but all things are not helpful, that is, all things are not expedient. All things are not constructive, that is, all things do not edify. And so, he says, let no one, no man, seek his own, but seek another's good. And then Paul concludes with some practical guidance for the mature Christian in regard to this matter. And we need to understand the context if we're to understand the particular passage that we're looking at. And all of that is a part of this context, and we need to go back and read it again and again and again. What about the historical principle? Well, Paul's allusions to the life of Israel and his understanding of current idolatrous practices, I think, must be understood historically. As a Pharisee, but even more, as a converted Jewish Pharisee, steeped in an understanding of his heritage, Paul could draw from that history, and he could show the way in which that history functions as a type, or he uses the phrase, a shadow of things to come, a type for those upon whom the ends of the ages are come. He knew the activity of ancient Israel could function as a warning for his readers. Many of them were familiar with that history, and even as Paul, they recognized that in that day, those were God's people. Whether they were faithful or unfaithful, they were God's people, and what God did with them and through them and what they did in response to or failure to respond to God's grace would give the people of God in this present age, these Corinthians, would give them encouragement or warning. Unlike our day, Paul saw history as significant and biblical history as imperative. It was from the Old Testament that he could draw material that not only spoke of a coming Messiah, but he could draw material that set out God's demands for a righteous people. But as a Hellenistic Jew, Paul also knew the history of the pagan religions. This is quite apparent in that masterful speech before the Dionysian court in Athens, which is recorded in Acts 17. He also knew the mystery religions and their notion, which is true and yet not true within the context of the mystery religions, that the religious participant in eating a common meal, or in the case of crude Mithraism, baptized by blood, actually believed that they were participating with their deity. Parallels could be drawn which had implications for both mature and immature Christians. One cannot participate in common pagan feasts, no matter how mature, without it affecting them, even the mature, affecting them and affecting others. After all, in true religion, one's participation in the symbols of death, the bread, the cup, become a recognition of lordship and commitment. Amen. And discipleship.
Amen.
So let me summarize. Koinonia was that common partnership shared by believers because of their participation in Christ. That's what I think it means in Acts 2:42. That certainly is what John sees it here in the first epistle, his first epistle, the first chapter, the first seven verses. And this communion or partnership was made possible by the Spirit of God, who comes to abide in the Christian and thus reflect the presence of the Father and Son, so that in the believer the fullness of the Godhead is apparent through the indwelling Holy Spirit. Mm-hmm. Philippians 2:4, 2 Corinthians 13:14, Hebrews 6:4, all seem to imply that. And certainly, if in the incarnation, the fullness of the Godhead, that's Paul's word. Amen. In Colossians 2:9, if that happened in Jesus of Nazareth, God's unique Son, then in the Christian faith response to the gospel, and in our baptism, a new incarnation takes place.
Amen.
And the Spirit brings to each believer's experience the fullness of the Godhead. Mm-hmm. We're an incarnational people.
Amen.
And we need to remember that. Not only in regard to this, but in regard to so many other things that are a part of our life in Christ. Interestingly, it is in the inner penetration of the Christian with Christ that we find the heart of communion or
Amen.
Fellowship or
Amen.
Participation. We see it in baptism. The obedient believer is baptized into Christ's death. He's buried as Christ's human body was buried. He's raised again even as Christ was raised. This is what that rich passage in Romans 6 indicates. And there develops an interpersonal relationship in which the cross becomes the motivating power. No wonder Paul would say there in the Galatian letter, chapter 6, by the cross the world is crucified to me and I to the world.
Amen.
And there in the second chapter of that same letter, verse 20, he had put that even more personally when he said, I have been crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I. Christ lives within me. And the life which I now live, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me.
Amen.
You see, we're baptized into one body. And there in 1 Corinthians 12:13, just a couple chapters later, Paul points out that not only are we baptized by the one Spirit into the one body, we're made to drink of that one Spirit. So all of us are made partakers of the Spirit, and in our weekly fellowship, we focus on Him who united us as one. And in the ancient world, a common meal was also a means of expressing that inner penetration, that partnership. In the New Testament church, it's more than a common meal, but it's that. And Paul's word of judgment in this next chapter, chapter 11, relative to not discerning the body, certainly has its primary meaning in not discerning or being concerned about the other members of the congregation. And that which transcends, you see, is the divine act by which salvation becomes possible, and a body, a fellowship of believers, a participant body of saints is created and expressed in the phrase, the blood of Christ. It is Jesus' death and his subsequent resurrection that creates this fellowship, this communion. Amen. It's in the body and blood of Christ that communion or fellowship in Christ is made real. But Paul shows that this is true even in pagan religions. If one sacrifices to an idol, one is joined to that idol, participates in the full range of whatever meaning that kind of idolatry involves. And so in the Old Testament, the priests participated in the sacrifices by eating the better portions of the sacrifices. And in the New Testament, we too participate in Christ's sacrifice. Amen. By virtue of our baptism and the continual remembrance of him in the breaking of the bread and the drinking of the cup. And just as God was active in our baptism, linking us to the efficacy of the blood, so he continues to act in the supper, bringing before us that same once-for-all sacrifice as the continuing basis of our salvation. Amen. In him. And thus we are baptized into him, into his death, and we continue our life in him, remembering and renewed by his blood. The cup which we drink, is it not a participation, a fellowship in the blood of Christ? The bread which we eat, is it not a fellowship, a participation in the body of Christ? We are one bread, one body, made so by one blood, the shed blood of the crucified, risen Christ. This is indeed what it means to say that we, by the cup of blessing, are participants in the blood of Christ. Thank you very much.
Amen. 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 Amen.